congratulations, and we welcome you into our service this great Sunday morning. And oh boy, what a service it's going to be, because we've come to lift up the name of Jesus, didn't we? Hallelujah. And so we want to take this opportunity to even welcome all of our virtuals who are signing in on our Facebook Live. We thank God for you. Thank you so much for tuning in and sharing with us wherever you may be tuning in. We welcome you this morning, and we hope to see you in person real soon. You can join us every Sunday morning here at our Houston campus at 10:30 a.m. or our Woodlands campus at 8:30 a.m. You can log on to our website at www.citycathedral.com for service times and information. And as a matter of fact, in a few seconds here, we're going to share with you our City Cathedral Praise Press. And once you hear those announcements that's coming on, you'll know that there's something good happening here at City Cathedral. We have so many things, and we want to keep you informed. So take a look at those, and then you'll join us right back here. So City Cathedral, would you clap your hands for all of our virtual brothers and sisters? Hallelujah.
Get ready for the annual Man in Demand Conference on Sunday, September 15th at 8:30 a.m. at the Woodlands Campus and 10:30 a.m. at the Houston Campus. You don't want to miss it. Attention all protege. Join us for our first annual Protege Prime, held at the City Cathedral Woodlands Campus Saturday, August 24th at 9 a.m. Topics include Preaching in an AI World, Dedicated to the Call, What's My Message, and much more. Registration is $25. Register today. For more information, please see Minister Marshall Armstrong. You don't want to miss this event. Leaders, don't forget, this month's DNA lab will take place on Wednesday, August 28th at 7 p.m. Be sure to check your emails and text messages for login credentials. You don't want to miss it. Protege, don't forget your monthly Zoom schedule on Wednesday, August 21st at 7 p.m. Please check your text and email messages for login credentials. If you want to know the happenings this week, please reference our weekly City Columns publication. Don't forget to patronize our family business. Do you want to further your Christian education? Enroll today in the Cononeo Theological College. Scholarships are available. Please sign up today or call the business office for more information. Do you love Starbucks? Then no need to stop before church to get your fix. Our very own coffee cafe is open each Sunday. Stop in and enjoy before or after service. I'm your announcing clerk, Ricky K. Williams. Let's give God a hand clap of praise.
Jesus, we bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, come on, everybody, put your hands together.
Let it be known that our God saves, our God reigns. We lift you up. Let it be known that love has come, love has won. We lift you up. Let it be known that our God saves, our God reigns. We lift you up.
We lift you up.
Let it be known.
Let it be known
that love has
that
come,
love has,
love has won.
Love has won.
We lift you up.
We lift you up.
Oh.
If you know it, help us sing.
Oh, 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 oh. Say, oh,
oh, oh,
say, oh,
oh, oh, oh.
I'm gonna do the thing real quick.
Hey, come on, let's turn it up. We're gonna sing it out for all the world to hear. There's love for everyone. A new day has begun. Something to shout about. Let it be known.
Let it be known that our God saves.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
We lift you up.
We lift you let up.
Let it be known.
Let it be known
that love has come.
Has
love has
love
won.
Has won.
We lift you up.
We lift
say,
you up.
Oh. Higher and higher, we shout your name out.
Hallelujah.
Louder and louder, you say.
We lift your name out.
Higher.
Higher and higher, we shout your name out.
Louder and
louder,
louder,
and louder.
We lift your name
we
up.
Lift your name
higher and higher.
Higher and higher,
we shout.
We shout your name out.
Louder,
louder and louder.
Louder. We lift
your name out. Higher
and higher.
Shout your name out.
Let it be known.
Let it be known
that our God saves. Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
We lift you up.
We lift you up.
Let it be known.
Let it be known.
The love has come.
Love has gone.
The love has
won. Love has won.
We lift you up.
We lift you up.
Hallelujah. Come on and give God a praise in this place. Come on and put your hands together. Song that we all know. It says, Jehovah, you,
yes, Lord.
I trust in you.
Hallelujah.
Oh Lord, Jehovah, you, I trust in you. Said, I believe
you.
I trust in you.
In you.
Oh Lord.
Oh Lord,
are God of wonders.
You are the God of wonders. You are the God all powerful. I believe.
I want to put your hands together. We're going to sing it one more time from the top. Everybody should know it. Yeah.
I trust
in you.
In you.
Oh Lord.
Oh Lord.
Jehovah.
You. I trust in you.
Sing, I believe.
I believe. I believe.
You are the God of miracles.
You are the God
of signs and wonders. To wave it goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Whatever it is you may be going through.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to my pain.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye to my sorrow.
Bye-bye.
You ain't welcome here.
Bye-bye.
You ain't welcome here.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
I serve your notice on today.
Bye-bye.
Till you ain't welcome here.
Bye-bye.
So long. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Whatever it is you may be going through.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
Say so long.
Bye-bye.
Say so long.
Bye-bye.
You ain't welcome here.
Bye-bye.
You ain't welcome here.
Bye-bye.
You ain't welcome here.
Bye-bye.
So long.
Bye-bye.
Come on and praise him in this place. Level in worship.
Yes,
just lift your hands in this place. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
like y'all know it, help me sing.
I have gone through.
Lord, it was you.
Lord, it was you.
One more time, say, it was you.
It was you.
Lord, it was you.
Lord, it was you.
Pulling me through.
Pulling me through.
Yeah. Say, when I stumble.
When I stumble.
When I cry.
When I cry.
When it felt like
wanted to die.
When my friends
hurt.
Everybody come on and sing. He'll never.
No, never.
No, never.
He'll never walk out on you.
He'll never walk out on you.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never. No, never.
I'm a witness.
I'm a witness.
That he'll never.
That he'll never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
Come on and clap those hands, everybody. No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
I'm a witness.
No, never.
No, never.
I wish I had a clap. Come on.
No, never.
Oh, oh, oh. No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
I'm a witness.
I'm a witness.
I'm a witness.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
You've got to know that God will never leave you nor forsake you.
Oh,
oh.
That he'll never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
I'm a witness.
He never.
No, never.
No, never.
Hey, ooh,
no, never.
I'm a
witness. Come on here.
That he'll never.
No, 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 never.
Oh.
No, never.
Oh.
No, never.
Oh.
Oh.
No,
oh.
No, never.
No, never.
I'm feeling that one, Shawanda.
No, never.
I'm a witness.
I'm a witness.
Oh.
That he'll never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
Come on and bless the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Did you come to bless him? Did you come to bless him? Did you come?
I'm a witness.
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 He'll never.
I'm a witness. I'm a witness.
I need you to turn to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm glad that you are here. Go ahead, go ahead. Go ahead, go ahead. Come on. Go ahead. All right, go to your other neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm happy that you are here and not there. Go ahead, go ahead.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Go ahead, go ahead.
I'm a
witness.
Come on, Shawanda. Come on, sing it. I'm a witness.
I'm a witness.
Come on here.
He'll
That's
never.
It. That's it.
Never.
That's it.
Never.
Come on, clap those hands. Everybody, come on. Clap those hands.
I'm a winner.
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 Yeah.
I'm a winner.
I'm a winner.
I'm a winner. Come on and clap those hands and bless the name of the Lord. Let's give a loud praise to this worship and praise. Let's give a loud clap to this worship and praise team. I need you to open your mouth. And I want you to do what the Bible has instructed us to do. Clap those hands from a place of triumph. You are not clapping those hands as a program filler. You're clapping those hands because you know that you have the triumph. You know that you have the victory. Hallelujah. Come on, get your mind off of me. Get your mind off of people. Put your mind on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Take your mind off of flesh and put your mind on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Those of you who are online, I welcome you. And begin to praise Him. Come on, begin to praise Him, begin to praise Him. That's the time, let the music rumble. Let your voices be loud. Yet let your hand clap. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, come on, come on, give him a spiritual chant. Hallelujah, come on, be free in the spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Come on, worship Him. I didn't tell you to stop. I didn't tell you to stop. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Come on, don't look around. Lock in. Praise the Lord. Come on, don't look. Lift your hands and praise the Lord. Come on, lift those hands. I say lift those hands and praise the Lord. Listen to my instructions. I need you to lift your hands because God wants you to receive the victory. Lift those hands unto the Lord. Oh, ye lamb, and serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Hallelujah. Come on, get out of the flesh. Hallelujah. Come on, so preaching can be easy. So your mind can be open. Lift those hands and wave your hands and praise Him, Lord. Praise Him, Lord. Hallelujah. Those of you who are online, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him. I feel your breakthrough. I feel your breakthrough. I feel your breakthrough. Come on, come on. Praise Him until you know He hears you. Praise Him until you know you got it. Come on, this is an apostolic moment. This is a Pentecostal moment. Minister Darian Jr., there's such a strong anointing in this building. The glory of the Lord is in this place. That's right. The transference of His anointing is so contagious. Hallelujah. Oh, that's right. Place that reprieve in your hand right now, every one of you. Every one of you. Minister Linda Hawkins, he's in this building. I know it. I feel it like you. Some of your hands are still lifted because you can't put them down. You can't. It's hard. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Place that reprieve in your hand. Sister Deborah, I hear the Spirit. You can shout from a place of triumph. I didn't say dance. You dance with your feet, you shout with your mouth. And it's in that order. From a place of triumph. See, the problem is we're trying to get to our future and we've not embraced or completed the past. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, in order to embrace your future, you've got to complete the past. Now, I'm not saying that you can't build your future from your future and your present. But you've got to finish. You've got to face what you're running from so that you can run to. Sing it, baby. Chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. In the book of John, chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. We'll skip over the Bible confessional. In the book of John, chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews. And now there in Jerusalem near the sheep gate, a pool which in the Aramaic is called Bethesda, which means house of mercy, and which is surrounded by the five covered colonnades. But here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. And one who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked the man, "Do you want to get well?" Instead of the man saying, "Yeah," verse 7, he says, "Sir, Jesus, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is bubbling. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up, pack up, walk up." At once the man was healed, and he picked up his mat and walked. How many know that when you do it God's way, the thing that you think that you need to wait on, you wouldn't have to? The Bible is silent, Sister Stephanie. He never did jump in. I want to use as a clarion to this little piece the illusion of the inclusion. Say it with me, the illusion of inclusion. Say it once again, the illusion of inclusion. All right, you may be seated. Illusion, illusion. Y'all give Shawanda, amen, hand clap. Amen, you did a good job. You are your worst enemy. Amen, you did a wonderful job. And you got to believe that. Don't you listen to the voice of the enemy. Hallelujah. You guys stay under me. I will pull your potential into a whole nother level. Because I see where fear is not trying to show you. Hallelujah. You did a wonderful job. Don't be so hard on yourself. Illusion of inclusion. Say it with me. Illusion of inclusion. Now, I'm not talking about somebody's sexuality, so please free yourself. I'm talking about, in this particular title, and go with me, and I'm going to make sense out of it because your rationale may jack up the title. I'm talking about embracing superficial engagement. Illusion of inclusion is the superficial engagement. It's pretending to receive other folks' feedback and input, and all alone, you won't act on it. You've evaluated their feedback, you've evaluated their suggestions and ideas, and yet you don't implement it. You're leading them to feel that they're value, and yet they are disregarded. The illusion of inclusion deals with that it is a sense of inclusion, but there is no real change. We're in the moment, but not seizing the moment. We are in the inclusion, but we are not seizing the moment, and so our inclusion becomes delusional because we're not confiscating the moment. We're not apprehending. We're not arresting and seizing the moment in the now, but not taking advantage of it. The illusion of inclusion really deals with it is a superficial engagement. I'm there, but I'm really not there. I'm in the room, but I don't know it. That I'm in my moment, but I'm not seizing the opportunity. I'm not arresting. I'm not comprehending the opportunity. I'm not confiscating, rather, the opportunity, because I don't necessarily know what an opportunity is. Because there are 3 degrees definitively of an opportunity. An opportunity is knowing what it is, knowing that you are in it, and then confiscating it, arresting the moment. Ain't no need in us claiming to be light and then never shine. That's delusional. Saying that you're saved and never act like you're saved. I don't hear nobody now. I come in peace. I'm just saying. So then, in this little thesis that I want to rest my hat, the same saints who just praise God, The illusion of inclusion is evident to three things. Number one, the false claim. Number three, the faith claim, or number two, rather. And number three, the forfeit consequence. The forfeit consequence. Number one, the false claim. Number two, the faith claim. And number three, the forfeit consequence. What's number one, class? Number two. Number three. Very good. It must be on the board. The illusion of inclusion is really dealing with the false claim. What I mean is, the false claim is claiming to have but not producing. It's an illusion of inclusion. It is a superficial engagement. In fact, go with me to the book of Mark. To the book of Mark chapter 11. The book of Mark chapter 11. Is it on the board? Verse 12. The book of Mark chapter 11. Let's just go there. Book of Mark chapter 11. All right. It says, next day as Jesus were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry. Next verse. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to find out if it had any fruit. And when he reached it, he found nothing but leaves because it was not its season. Next verse. Then Jesus cursed the tree. May no one ever eat fruit from you again. And his disciples heard him say it. Go back to verse 12. That the tree was in full leaf. And when Jesus approached the tree, he saw that there was no fruit. And so he cursed the tree. Agriculturally, the appearance of leaves was evidence of twigs and not figs. And yet Jesus would curse the tree, not because the tree did not have figs, because it was not the tree's season to have figs. You just read it. And so why hold the tree hostage for not bearing figs when it was not its season to bear it? He did not curse the tree because the tree did not have figs. He cursed the tree because the tree had the appearance of full leaves and no twigs. Lord, help us. Because the twig was an edible fruit that would have given Jesus the energy he needed for the next ministerial task. In other words, he curses the tree for not bearing fruit when it had the leaves as evidence that it had some type of fruit. Lord, have mercy. The spirit of hypocrisy, the spirit of pretending to be everything that you are not, the spirit of having leaf and, listen, plenty of leaves and yet no substance, claiming to have and yet not producing. It is like of being in the room or experiencing the law of inclusion and yet not experiencing the essence of what you are made out of. And so he cursed the tree for not bearing twigs, not figs, but twigs. Now the cousin scripture, it's taken from the book of Matthew chapter 5, where it talks about that we are the salt of the earth. And anytime the salt will lose its saltiness, it's good for nothing. So there again, the salt now is cursed, not because Jesus is mad with salt. Because the salt had no business of not being salty. Because salt is an influential element. It's likened to us who are saved, automatically you have influence. Having influence and not being influential is a false claim. It's an illusion of inclusion that you've been included within the affidavit of God and yet not producing. And so that's why the Lord has to cut on us so that we can become productive. How many know that pruning ain't pretty, but it is productive? He cuts the tree. He trims the tree so that the tree can become more productive. So sometimes the Lord allows you to go through the upheavals of life discomforts of life so that he can prune you, so that you can produce much. Because sometime in our production of the sameness, we can become content and complacent. And so the Lord will rough up a few things. He will shake up a few things so that we can become more productive. So sometimes he don't answer every prayer you pray, because he's trying to teach you waiting skills. He's trying to teach you patience. I mean, you know that waiting time ain't wasted time. It's just a matter of time. How then can we claim to be salt and not be salty? We need to be influencing others, not others influencing you. How then can we claim to have fire and not be hot when our hotness has become notness? I wish I had somebody here. How many know that a cold spoon would never melt ice cream? I don't care how much you want to do it, but if you heat that spoon up, it'll change the physiology. I wish I had somebody here. The inclusion, the illusion of the inclusion is it is a superficial engagement. Y'all stay with me now. The Lord wants you to produce the essence of you or the exactness of you. We've been born from that incorruptible seed. We ought to be acting like children of the Most High God. I'll be talking about next week, love. I'm just giving you a little bit of a prelude of what the sermon will be, that if we have the love of Jesus on the inside, there should be no reservations of loving each other as you have loved yourself. Otherwise, it would be delusional. Say that I have God factor on the inside and hating on his children and his creatures and creation. Albert Einstein saying one of the greatest intelligence, the proof of intelligence, is when we can love each other and get along. Oh, I can count those amens. So the false claim is that we can't be claiming to have and yet not producing the very thing that we are claiming to have. It's the illusion of inclusion. The illusion of inclusion is evident in three things. Number one, the false claim. Number two, watch this, the faith claim. All right, go with me to the book of James chapter 1. The book of James chapter 1, go there real quickly. It says, don't just merely listen to the word, but don't do what it says. In translation, don't just be hearers, but be doers. Because to only be hearers and never do, it is a false faith claim. It is the illusion of the inclusion is that we know the word, we've heard the word, we hear the word, and yet we don't do the word. All right? Underscore the word do. I'm going somewhere. The word do is poietes. It is P-O-E-I-T-E-S. 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 Whatever is happening, let's let it happen. Let's let it happen. The word is sacred. Poietes, P-O-E-I-T-E-S. It is where you get the word poet. All right. The word poet is a poetic gesture. Poet gesture deals with acting elements. That's why the scripture is called the scripture. Because you got to know the script in order to act out Bible. And you can't be proficient in the scripture unless you practice the script. And the script is the word of God. So he says, don't just be hearers, but also be actors, not from a pretense standpoint, but to be actors of God's word, or rather to activate God's word. And there's a reason behind that, because if you were to go to James chapter 2, verse 26, it says, as it is the Bible, or the Bible is affixed from oxygen, would ultimately die. So it is, faith without works is dead. Many scholars believe that Paul had some type of anatomical, biological experience, information, that he was talking about body. And he was talking about that if the body is absent of oxygen, physical breathing, breath, the body will die. All right, some of y'all looking at me new as if, no, that's not true. All right, hold your breath for 3 minutes. You're either going to fall out, you're going to faint, or you're going to ultimately die because your body needs to breathe. It needs oxygen. So it is, if the word is to survive, you have to activate God's word. Activating God's word is likened to breathing. It is likened to infusing breath, wind, oxygen, pneuma into the word of the Lord. And so we move from written word, which is dead word. It's dead. It's dead to us if we don't apply it. It's life in it only through application. So we understand that in order for us, watch this, to activate God's word by way of understanding, we must embrace the book of Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Now faith cometh by hearing, out of hearing by the word of the Lord. Hearing, ekouo, A-K-O-U-O, from a place of understanding. So I'm hearing from a place of understanding. My understanding licensed me to activate God's word because faith is actionary. All right, go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. It says, and then walk by faith. How many know that walk is an active dynamic? Walk by faith. Walk by faith and not by sight. Walk by faith and not by sight. So faith is actionary. And the reason why faith is actionary, because God gave you faith. All right, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 through 9. It says that there are many gifts, different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit that does them all. Next verse, look what it says. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. Next verse. Different kinds of working, but all of them and in every one, it is the same God that works. And if you were to read verse 7, 8, and 9, it says there's a gift of faith. Now, faith is a gift because everybody can activate it. God gave you faith so that we won't be lazy in how we approach the word. Lord have mercy. So man is without an excuse that I can't do it. If you have understanding, you can. So faith coming out of hearing, hearing by the word of the Lord. Now faith is a gift, and faith has to be activated. Why? Because faith is actionary. It's actionary. Say for me, faith is actionary. Say it once again, faith is actionary. Now go with me to the book of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Because now we're ready. See, the problem is we're trying to get to the now before the then. We're trying to get to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 before we've studied James 1, James 2, and 2 Corinthians, and Romans chapter 10. We can't just skip those chapters and verses and books and then just launch into the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse 1. Now that we've studied James, now that we've studied Romans, now that we've studied 1st and 2nd Corinthians, now faith is the substance. Lord have mercy. Of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. Faith is the substance of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. It's almost like this scripture is hyperbole. It's almost like this scripture is oxymoronic. Because then how can something that you don't have become evidence because you're still operating in the hope? But now once we've met the requisite of Romans, 2 Corinthians, and James 1 and 2, we're ready for the now, Stephanie. That faith, now faith is the substance of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. In other words, what I'm believing God for, I have a right to it because it already exists in my evidence to expectation. All right. If the substance of steak is the broth. That didn't work. The substance of smothered chicken, Sister Bell, is the gravy. So he says, now the substance become the evidence that it does exist, that gravy has, listen, if it tastes like chicken because of the gravy, it is chicken. So the gravy is the evidence that chicken was mixed. All right. In other words, now faith is the substance of understanding. Faith is the understanding that what I'm expecting God to do for me, I have a right to have it because it already exists in his word. So what I'm believing God for is my substance. In other words, God gives me a taste before I can get it. So I can, listen, so my taste become a platform to practice my praise. So once I get it, my praise take on a whole nother octave. So I don't have to shout after I get it. I can praise him because of the substance of what his word says. So I'm acting like I already have it before I had it. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, now faith is the substance. I'm already hired before I get hired. I'm already walking in it before I own it. I'm already healed before I, because it becomes my substance. Ain't no need you walking. Ain't no need you believing God's word if you don't know that you have a right to it. Now the problem is though, we sort of like the read verse 1, chapter 11, Hebrews. And we love to read verse 6. Faith pleases God. And we skate over Romans and 2 Corinthians and 1 Corinthians and James 1 and James 2. We don't necessarily like that because that's work and that's preparation. But if you understand in reading verse 6 as a prelude, as an encouragement for you to hang out with Romans 10:17, that faith pleases God. The word please is eucharisteo. It is the understanding for the favor of, and that God is going to give you, watch this, accelerated favor. Lord have mercy. So then, watch this. Don't expect God to please, to be pleased with a faith we approve. He ain't going to give you no favor, even if you're walking by faith, if you ain't ready for it. But I would rather be walking by faith and not be ready for it than to not walk by faith and never be ready. So part of the incentive of walking by faith is that God is pleased. And when he pleased, he'll give you favor. Lord have mercy. I know your money is satisfying all of your desires. I know that your resources are satisfying all of your desires, but there will come a time to where money, resources, people, things, and places probably won't meet your desired place. And it's going to require your walking by faith so that you can please God for favor. Because favor know how to qualify you even when your name and your credit is jacked up. I wish I had somebody. So now, faith is the substance of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. Because faith pleases God. Faith pleases God. So our expectation is largely formed by that resolved truth. That if we understand that God finds pleasure in our faith walk and not necessarily the better behavior. Because he's not impressed because this week we didn't sin. I don't care if you've not sinned in 2 months, you're still dirty t-shirts. The Bible says we are filthy rags in measure to the clean rag. So if we are to not embrace this illusion of inclusion, We just can't be comfortable in being hearers, Deacon Jones, of the word and not doers. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, you've got to do the word now. You've got to do the word. But then lastly, we have to understand that if we become comfortable with this illusion of inclusion, we run the risk of forfeiting consequences or forfeiting opportunities. Jesus is now leaving from the Passover feast in Jerusalem. Now there in Jerusalem near the sheep gate, the Bible says, is a pool which in the Aramaic is called Bethesda, or the house of mercy, which is surrounded by five porches where sick people would gather. Whatever blessings that you are waiting for, it has to be met with God's mercy. Don't ever feel that what you are trusting God for, that you've merited it. It's unmerited favor. The one who was there, had been paralyzed for 38 years, the Bible says. And in verse 6, when Jesus learned that the paralyzed man was in this condition a long period of time, he asked him, do you want to get well? He asked him. When Jesus found out that this paralyzed invalid man was there for 38 years, you would think that Jesus would have known. I wish I had some linguistic students. You would think that he would have known that for 38 years doing the same thing, that he wanted to get well, and yet when Jesus learned that he's been there doing the same thing with that condition, he asked him, do you want it? Lord, have mercy. It's like a person that every year they get depressed because stuff ain't fitting. And you got some folk in your circle of influence that are fans and don't want to run the risk of offending you, but you need some people who's not impressed with you and would run the risk to tell you the truth by saying every year you get crazy. So I need to know, because you're on two different high blood pressure pills and you're still hanging around with Polk. So I need to know, are you serious about your health? I wish I had somebody. You got some folk that's hating on you because you are watching your weight. You on the track jogging. You're watching what you eat. Everything that you wear lays on you. I wish I had. And now they're upset with you, not because you've done something to them. They just don't want to leave the bluebell alone. They don't want to. It's like this. Jesus asked, are you serious? So I have nobody to help me. And this was his response. I have nobody to help me in the pool when my opportunity presents itself. And when I try to get in the pool, somebody else jump in. That's not what I ask you. In verse 8, the reason why you feel you need to wait on the existence of others is because of two things. Number one is you don't want it bad enough. Number two, you are convinced and have co-signed that your present dilemma has disqualified you. Lord have mercy. So I have conditioned myself to be comfortable year after year, which is called dysfunction. It's a dysfunctional behavior to keep doing the same thing for 38 years and expecting a different result when the people that carried you near the pool were too selfish to put you in the pool. It's sad to be connected to people who can help you but yet won't help you. They have the resources that you need. They have all the things that you need, but they won't help you. Look at your neighbor next door. It could be your context clue to tell them you are the wrong friend. Ain't no need you having friends around you, and every now and then you can't lean on them. Oh, look at your neighbor one more time and say, neighbor, talk back to the pastor. Come on. Sometimes we forfeit the opportunity because we have been delayed as a codependent in waiting on others to get for us what we can truly get for ourselves. I like to call it illusion for the inclusion. In the moment, but I ain't seizing the moment. In the now, but I ain't seizing the now. Everybody else, you watching everybody else get blessed. It's time for you to stop celebrating and start celebrating your own. They brought the paralyzed man to the pool, but they did nothing to help him get in the pool. I like to call them dysfunctional enablers who won't challenge you to step in and get in. But yet they will encourage you to settle for what's not working as a new norm. And when I am content with much of the same, then I will resist the need to walk in change. When the opportunity comes, I'm going to seize the moment. And that's what Jesus was saying. He challenged his potential. And listen, I don't want you to get upset with me because I'm challenging what you don't see. I see you walking. I see you getting up. I see you packing up. I see you doing what you think you cannot do. You must permit the disappointment of others to motivate you as a demand to claim your independence. You've got to embrace those who are not putting you front line. To not discourage you, but to motivate you to put a demand that this is the last time that I'm going to be overlooked. And so Jesus says, get up, pack up, and then walk up. In order for change to happen, you must be the change that you want to see. And sometimes that change that you want to see depends on your modifying your behavior. One of the reasons why people don't get what they want is because they won't decide to get what they want. Can I say it one more time? One of the reasons why people won't get what they want is because they won't decide to get what they want. One of the reasons why we can't get what we want is because we won't decide to get what we want. Jesus understood that what you are waiting on is based on your decision. The man replied, I have nobody to put me in the pool when the opportunity comes. You can't settle with the outmost mentality. Let me say it once again. You cannot settle with not having enough. I need you to shake your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, stop waiting on folk. Because I found out folk got the same problem you got. They need to be healed just like you. You need to surround yourself with folk already got it. You first, I already got it. Jump in. Oh, touch your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I probably can't jump in, but I ought to be able to slide in. You got to use what you have. You've got to use your leg as a kickstand. You got to drag yourself. You would think year after year that he will learn the lesson. What he been doing wasn't working. I need you to shake your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, but try it differently. You need somebody in your life who can see beyond your faults, who can see beyond your disabilities, who can see beyond your shortfalls. Get in. I need you to look at your neighbor next door and tell them, neighbor, you've been sitting on the sideline too long. I need you to get in. But before I can pick up, I've got to get up. I've got to get up. Somebody say, I will arise. I'm going to get up. I'm going to stand up. I'm going to pick up. And I'm going to walk up. The Bible says, what did he pick up? He picked up his mat. Hey, when you do it God's way, God will have you to carry what used to carry you. High five your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, what used to defeat me can't defeat me no more. What used to keep me in condition can't condition me anymore. I rise. I'm getting up. Let me talk to you right now. Let me prophesy to you. I need for you to get up. You've been down too long. Get up. You've been hurt too long. Get up. You've been lonely too long. Get up. You've been sad too long. Get up. You've been discouraged too long. Get up. You've been broke too long. Get up. You've been deceived too long. Get up. You've been depressed too long. Get up. You've been low too long. Get up. Some of y'all self-esteem is so low because you've been hanging around the wrong fella. He gonna always put you down because he don't see your potential. I'm not telling nobody to leave, but I'm telling you to make a change. I wish I had somebody. Oh, lean over to the neighbor next door and say, neighbor, it's time to get up from there. When you get up, you wouldn't have to jump in like the rest of them. You wouldn't have to work overtime like the rest of them. Somebody say, get up, baby, get up, get up, get up. Tell your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I'm gonna get up, I'm gonna get up. Don't be selfish. Prophesy to your next neighbor and say, neighbor, you can do it. What do you have to lose? You ain't happy no way. Get out. I'm only talking to those who have said, I can do better all by myself. I can do better all by myself. I'm just wondering though. My God, baby Raven, I'm just wondering, those who brought him to the pool, not one of them had sympathy. Could it be them so-called friends are too selfish to see you get blessed first? I don't want to hang around nobody that I got to hide my blessing because don't even come over to my house because you may hate me even the most. You don't need no friends if you got to use words because you don't want to make them feel bad because you got it. Friends without ought to celebrate you with because they know that they're next in line. Because if God did it for you, he's going to do it for me. I don't have that many. That's the problem. Having too many is going to delay your breakthrough. 38 years, that's too long. That's too long. No, let that grip. That's too long. That's too long to abort That's too long to allow opportunities to pass you by. That's too long. And I come to challenge every person that I license you to get sick and tired of being sick and tired of doing the same thing over and over. The more you do, the more they hurt you. You've got to delete them quickly. Don't be scared. I got you. The more you do, the more you give, the less they like you.
Yes, sir.
Don't you give another dime. And I need you to tell yourself, self is in session this year. Where you going? None of your business. Because you may be the very person that are breaking my house while I'm going for 2 weeks. I ain't telling you nothing. You should have stayed home. You listen to what I'm saying? I got preachers that I cover, and they're good to me, and I love them. But I got other colleagues in the city. They got a problem with me. And you ask them, what has he done? Nothing. They just assess my anointing in my blessed place. I said humbly. But if I was unsaved, I'd say something else. I don't give a doggone. I need some help, Miss Bell. I don't give a doggone. I don't give a doggone. You can hate me or not. I don't care. Because you ain't giving me nothing no way. Well, I'm trying to impress you. Can I hear? Yeah, well, that's my first cousin. First cousin, deleting. Because you're the reason why I don't have nothing. And they can sift it out. You don't have to tell them you got a little increase. They know. They can spill it. They'll call you. You ain't heard from them in 6 months. And they dial the phone. I was just checking how you doing. I got to list something. Y'all got to do some of these folk like you do the bill collectors. Look at the phone, don't answer. You just got to just do that. God has blessed you, and then they're there. If folk don't change their behavior, their blessing won't fix it. I'm trying to help you. I'm teaching you right now. Yeah, but they need help with their car note. If whatever happened caused them to have some situations with the car, your helping them won't help them if they still have bad stewardship. The best help that you can give them is advice. Next time, pay your bill. And never get something that you can't afford. And it could be afford. Little ticket items ain't bad. Small ticket items. Amen. Stay away from big ticket items if you can't afford it.
Yes.
Amen. Let your money work for you. Let it be a wise investment. Hallelujah. All right, I'm done. Because some people are saying that I hold y'all too long. Amen. I ain't gonna hold you. It's 12. Come on, clap your hands to the Lord. I'm done. The illusion of inclusion, we're going to not be superficially engaged. But we're going to be authentically engaged. Are you listening to what I'm saying? So, Father, as we leave this place, but never from your proximity, God, we really do pray for traveling grace. As we make ready to receive this offertory worship, I need you to give us a mind right now. Every person, begin to pray that God will increase your faith to give without fear. Because the Bible says he blessed a cheerful giver. He'll bless you. He'll bless you. He'll bless your life. Hallelujah. But you got to be liberal. You got to be liberated. And then you got to be liberal in your giving. Because you've got to know that God is attached to the promises of His word. That if you give, it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. He'll cause men to use their power, ability, and influence to bless your life. Those of you who are online right now, I want you to give the largest seed you can. The biggest seed you can, I want you to give right now. Those of you who are here live in all three sections, I want you to give right now. I want you to not take the restraints off of God and just trust Him, because if you need a breakthrough financially, that's all the more that we need to be giving right now. Those of you who are in the youth church, I want them to give too as well. Every person under the sound of my voice. Everything that we can do as we call ministry, we can do it through tithe and offerings. We can do it through tithing and offerings. Right before you leave, there's going to be an empowerment symposium that we have every second Sunday or every quarter, rather. And we have guests, we have people, we have members of the church that's going to share their expertise and how to empower you to be financially independent. These are not schemes, these are principles. These are ways and means that you can use that can garner you increase in your finances. Every person right now, every person, I want you to take the restraints from your giving. I want you to take the restraints from your giving. And I want you to trust God that if you will obey God in your seed, He's going to give you more than enough, more than what you've sown, according to His word. You're in this place right now. You're in this place. You're all right? You're in this place. Every person. Raise your hand if you need a tithe envelope. Raise your hand if you need a tithe envelope. Give me an envelope and a pen. Give me an envelope and a pen. I want you to come. I want you to come. I want you to come. Those of you, if you want to join the church, thank you, sister. If you want to join the church, I want you to stand. I want you to come. I want you to come. If you want to join the church, I want you to come. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. If you want to come, I want you to join the church. Thank you. I want you to join. By way of membership, God bless you. We would love to have you. God bless you, brothers and sisters. Thank you so much. Those of you, God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, every person, every person, every person. Every person. Come on down here. Come on down in any order. Come on down. Everybody stand. Come down. Those of you who are online, come on, give electronically. Those of you who want to give electronically in the rear of the church, please do that. Go online. It'll be a blessing. Bless me. Be a blessing to the body of Christ. Thank you. Be a blessing to the body of Christ. Sister Grace, we're praying for you, my dear sister. We're praying for you. We're praying for you. We're praying for you. The blessings of the Lord. May He give you choice blessings. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I'll be interceding today on your behalf, calling your name up before the Father. Hallelujah. Anyone else? Anyone else? Anyone else? I'm going to believe that God is going to give you increase as a result. Thank you, Sister Bell. God bless you for your electronic giving. God bless you. Thank you, Sister Raven, all the way from L.A. Got that master's degree, going for her doctorate one day. Ain't God good? Amen. You tell Debbie Allen I said hello. Amen. Praise the name. Praise God. We thank God for it. Anyone else who want to help us? Anyone else who want to help us? Anyone else? Be a blessing. Anyone else? Anyone else? Come on, stand. Stand. Everybody. Everybody. Anyone else? Were you blessed today? I know I'm passionate. Were you blessed today? Yeah. worship for increase. All of my praises.
I pray for increase.
Bless me. Everybody sing it together.
I pray for increase.
Father, we thank you for this level of giving. We need you to breathe upon it, touch it. We worship you with it. If you're the same God that divided the two fish, five loaves of bread, fed thousands and upon thousands and then leftovers, more than enough. God, give us that same touch point over our substance, over our seeds. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Just so it cannot be otherwise. Amen. Amen. Would you pray for me? Jesus is the light that surrounds us. He's the love that enfolds us. He's the presence that watches over us. He's the power that protects us. Wherever we are, God is. Wherever I am, God is. And wherever God is, all is well. And so it is. You're dismissed. Thank you for coming. Listen. The brothers, all of the brothers.